I would probably do high school all over again. I think that I probably wasn't that great a student, and if I was able to do it again, I'd probably be in a better position now, both academically and maybe even physically. But yeah.
Actually, I think I would have stuck to dancing. I stopped doing that at the end of grade 10, and I did it for about 7 or 8 years, and I really miss it, so I would keep doing that.
I think there's a lot of things in life that I would do all over again, but yeah, just knowing that we don't actually have to, because Jesus has just made everything okay through his sacrifice, so yeah, we don't have to worry about all those things that did in a way.
No, I don't know if there's anything I'd be. There's probably lots of things that I'd do over again if I had the chance, but nothing major or life-changing that I can think of, so.
I start to think about some of the friendships that I've lost over the years, and how I would maybe approach those friendships a bit differently, and also, I guess, conversations that I've had with other people about Jesus and God. I'd probably redo those.
I really enjoy a cup of coffee, but I could do without the caffeine addiction, so probably cut that.
Oh, I feel like I wish I could redo every conversation I have. I often say silly and thoughtless things, and I think back and think, oh, I wish I could say something differently. So pretty much I think that every day.
Do you want to do that again?
Good morning, my name's Mitch. It's lovely to be with you on this Easter Sunday, and I don't know what you've done in your life that you regret. I certainly have done a few things. We're going to read the Bible again before we have a look at it, from 1 Corinthians 15 this time. It's on page 1154 of the Church Bibles. First Corinthians 15, starting from verse 3. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12, and after that he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom were still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared also to me as to one abnormally born. I'm the least of the apostles and do not even deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God was with me. Whether then it is I or they, this is what we preach, and this is what you believed. But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we're found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. But he did not raise him, if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, you are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. Well, let me pray for us. Father, it's wonderful to have a day where we can remember one of the central claims of Christianity, that the Lord Jesus died and was raised to life. as we wrestle with that this morning, we pray that you challenge our thoughts about the resurrection and you'd comfort us with everything that it means. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Well, I don't know if you've ever been on the receiving end of some promises that didn't come through, but pretty much when any leader makes some bold promises that don't come through, the result is we end up being a little bit disillusioned, disinterested, apathetic, even a little bit angry. Some of our leaders over the past 10 years or so have made some massive promises. I don't know if you remember 2007 and Kevin 07, who was promising a massive new era of something or other that I was swept up in, but it very quickly disappeared and many people became disillusioned. Recently, our current Prime Minister, Tony Abbott, has promised to fix our money problems, and let's hope he does. But many people have found themselves disillusioned at his inability to do that without taking money off them. And even more profoundly, in 1993, Mitch Smart promised that no rainy day would be a rainy day with him as school captain at McLean Primary School. Needless to say, it rained. And many were disillusioned. On Easter Sunday, we come together to remember some enormous promises. The promise that there is a new type of life. Life that's good because it's life that lasts forever with the living God. And it's based completely on the fact that Jesus is resurrected from the dead. It is a huge and profound promise. Particularly today when we are in a culture conditioned not to believe something like the resurrection of the dead. Just like the Corinthians, people are saying there's no resurrection of the dead. You can't scientifically repeat it and test it, it doesn't happen. Life after death is an incredible claim, especially when mostly what we experience is gathering barnacles until we wind down to death. I mean, I don't want to get too dark too early. There are a bunch of good parts to life, like this long weekend and the opportunities to see friends and family, but let's not muck around. Life is essentially slowly gathering barnacles until we've got so many that it drags us under. Whether it be what Jess described in that video, friendships neglected and lost, Mel's regrets of bad conversation, Tom's collection of habits that he wishes he didn't have. These are the kind of things that just stick to us. It's before we even get to stuff between us and God. If there's no resurrection, we have a major problem. We have no certainty about what is going on and how much is stuck to us and how it might be removed. Then there's the physical stuff. Sore knee, leaky heart, high blood pressure, one medication, two medication, four medication, a Webster pack, who knows? That's one for the older people in there. It all just adds to the simple fact that we are living people steadily gathering more and more issues until we're dead. On a day like today, when we remember the resurrection, Christians are really vulnerable. Because if it's not true, we are people giving false hope and wrong hope, charlatans selling a Ponzi scheme. I don't know if you heard that reading that I did for you just before, but that's exactly what the first Christians themselves thought. If there's no resurrection, they said, we are actually a joke. Our reading was from a letter sent to the ancient city of Corinth. One of the issues there, just like today, was that people were saying, you know what, dead people just don't come back to life. And the Apostle Paul is saying, you've got to realize what that means. If that's the case, the whole Christian movement ought to collapse under the weight of embarrassment. Let me remind you of some of the words. If there's no resurrection of the dead, not even Christ has been raised. If Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, so is your faith. We're false witnesses about God. We've testified that God has raised Christ from the dead. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You're still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. Very strong language. See, for the first followers of Jesus, it was not primarily about Jesus being a good teacher or a miracle worker, not mainly about Christ dying on the cross for their sins, but it all hinged on this, that without the resurrection, it was all hopeless. Without it, they were just like every other group, who has seen its leaders' promises fade. And Christianity should have faded under the scorching light of truth. Because, you know, if you go back to the start of the Christian movement, it was never one of those movements that gathered so much momentum that Jesus died and then it just kept pushing forward. Like Martin Luther King Jr. in the civil rights movement. The thing about Martin Luther King was that he started a movement that gathered crowds and momentum and a sense of justice, and what he was doing was right, and he died and the movement carried on, and it does to this day. It's not what happened with Jesus. It wasn't like that. If you're on the outside looking in, here's what you would have seen with Jesus. We've got a guy who grows up in essentially a single-parent family. Joseph and Mary were there at the start. By the time Jesus is a teenager, Joseph is not spoken of. He's gone. He does a trade, he learns to be a chippy, and he lives in an insignificant town on the rump of the Roman Empire. Earlier in Mark's Gospel, Mark tells us that people were actually bemused the idea that Jesus might be the leader of a significant movement. Mark chapter 6, verse 3 says, "Isn't this the carpenter? Isn't this Mary's son and the brother of James and Joseph and James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? Aren't his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Just a carpenter, one of Mary's kids. And he starts his public ministry in a very unorthodox way. I mean, you know, if you're going to start a business, don't do what Jesus did here. If you're going to start a business, you go looking for the bright talent, the young up-and-coming people who work for nothing and are full of ideas, and the older people who can steady the ship with a bit of experience. But Jesus doesn't go looking for the special religious people, or to the temple, or to the synagogue. He doesn't even watch people to see if they practice their religion well. He goes to the lake, and he gets some fishermen. Some people who are less qualified and arguably less socially placed than Jesus. So we see in Mark chapter 2, Jesus walks beside the Sea of Galilee. He sees Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake. They were fishermen. "Come and follow me," he says, and they do. He starts his ministry, and even though he does incredible things and he says incredible things, the people who should be excited by this, the religious leaders, the Pharisees, think he's a dangerous, fast-talking rebel. The secular leaders, Herod and his followers, think exactly the same thing. In fact, in Mark chapter 3, the Pharisees went out and they plot with the Herodians about how they might kill Jesus. Jesus has no money and no wealth and no possessions. He can't gather an army and make swords and make weapons, because Luke and Matthew tell us that foxes have holes, the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man doesn't have anywhere to go to sleep. And rather than gathering momentum as he goes along, halfway through Mark's Gospel, Jesus starts losing it. The miracles slow down. The crowds diminish. One by one, his band of 12 fishermen followers jump ship. Judas sells him out in chapter 14. Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went to the chief priests to betray Jesus. They were delighted, and they promised to give him money. And then the good guy, Peter, he's the only one left, the only hope of momentum for Jesus. But then even Peter pretends he doesn't know who Jesus is. Peter sitting in the courtyard watching Jesus on trial. A servant girl sees Peter and she says to those standing around, "This fellow is one of them, he's one of Jesus' followers." And Peter denies it. See, Jesus had promised forgiveness and new life, and right near the end of his gospel, not even his biggest fans are buying it. Without the resurrection of Jesus, the story of Jesus' life is the beginning of a bold movement gathering barnacles until a weak and lonely death. Grand promises followed by a very awkward wind down. See, it's incredibly easy to follow a leader when they've got momentum and their promises are going well. Every politician in the run-up to when they get voted in, everyone is behind them and they really want to do it. "As I made those promises to be school captain in 1993, everyone is behind me to do it. Jesus Christ makes the promises. I tell you the truth. No one who has left home or brother or sister or mother or father or children or fields for me in the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age and in the age to come eternal life." grand promises. But when the rubber hits the road, grand promises usually smash to the ground and people resort to apathy and disinterest. See, the first followers of Jesus, when Jesus died, these 12 fishermen and tradies with him are suddenly lower class, out of work people with nothing to rely on. Every level of society is opposed to them and they've got no power. You know, this morning I almost did, when I was thinking about this, I almost thought what I'll do is compile a list of reasons why you can believe the resurrection. You're probably glad I didn't do that because it would have been really boring, but it's quite persuasive. I mean, there's stuff like the first witnesses to the resurrection were women. Now, to us in our modern society, we're like, well, that's fine. But in their day, there's a guy called Celsus. He's a Greek philosopher, and he says, you can't trust women. They're hysterical. And in the Christian gospel, the first witnesses to the resurrection are women. And for the first Christians, it's so embarrassing. But you'd only do that if that's what happened. I could have gone through stuff about how we know which tomb it was and why it was the right tomb. I could have gone through how many times in that reading from Mark they say he's dead. It's four times in the space of two sentences. Just so we know, you know what, he was dead. I could have gone through all of that. And if you want to, we've actually got a book called The Case for Easter. It's up the back on the foyer table. You can have it. It's yours for free. It goes through all of that stuff. But I didn't do that because, frankly, I think one of the most compelling reasons to believe the resurrection is what happens next. Within 40 days of the resurrection, 120 people are Christian. 50 days later, 3,000 are. Within 3 months, there are 5,000. Within 3 years, former Christian killer Saul of Tarsus has converted to Christianity. Within 10 years, the Christian movement has made it to Greece and Turkey and all around the Mediterranean, including Egypt, where the author of Mark's Gospel, Mark himself, goes. Within 40 years, most of the New Testament is written as the Holy Spirit moves the first followers to write this stuff down for the next generation. Within 50 years, the first church networks are popping up. It's no longer just the church in Ephesus, but the churches in Ephesus as they gather together. By 100 AD, the entire New Testament is written down, and then the second level of pop literature is coming out called the Didache, which advises people on how to live for Jesus. And all of this, when Christians were poor and hated and in the minority and killed for entertainment, all of this before any political ruler took their side. And all of this from a handful of fishermen and a few women who just saw Jesus die. It's implausible, isn't it? Because all of this is from a resurrected Saviour who took the lives of sinful, dying people and turned their world inside out. All this group of 12, all these women with them had ever known is a life of gathering barnacles, regrets, sins, physical illness, the slow wind down until they die. All they'd ever known is leaders who promise big and then fade. But now they had witnessed something different. A new type of life that means they're no longer living people gathering junk on the way to death. They now know they're dying people. But just like Jesus, they're on their way to life. When they throw their lot in with him, when they throw themselves into the hands of Jesus, it all changes. Just like him, they can look forward to a time when every part of this life for them, every sin, every regret, every illness is scraped up and they pop out through the graves. So convinced of it, so shocked by it, they turn into a movement that could not be stopped by anything, not even death. Because they knew that couldn't hold them down. In their otherwise pitiable, hopeless confidence came from the Christian creed, Christ has been raised. The Apostle Paul concludes his discussion about the resurrection like this. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, the last trumpet. The trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable and will be changed. When the perishable has been clothed with imperishable and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he's given us victory through the Lord Jesus Christ. Look, if you're here this morning and you've not thought much about the resurrection, let me tell you why you should. First reason, Alan Jones is wrong. Christians are not actually people to be admired, not people to be joined in with, who are hoping for something good. We're to be treated as a joke, and we're to be pitied. And if the resurrection is not true, you have to deal with the fact that your life is essentially gathering barnacles of regret and physical problems and sin until you die. There'll be some good times, but you have to face the reality you have no basis for real hope. Right now you are in the majority, I understand that, and sometimes I'm envious of the comfort that brings. And the resurrection is difficult to comprehend. But it turned the world of those 12 people and their few friends upside down. And it's turned the world of millions upside down since, and maybe today. He could do that for you. Because once you trust Jesus, the news of Easter Sunday is an absolute delight. Because you can join us in celebrating a new life with God and guaranteed new life. I don't know how you came here this morning. If you're anything like us, it was all a bit disorganized and then you were here. But I can tell you how you should walk out. You should walk out like Elise in the video we watched, who knows that in the best words she can, because of Jesus, it's all okay. What defines our future is not our past, but the resurrection that turns our world inside out. And if you're carrying a long history of sin and torrid behavior that now makes you blush at the thought of it, trust Jesus. He's buried it, it's dead, and you're a new creation. If you've been gathering hurts and sorrows that seem disproportionate to everyone around you, trust Jesus. It's not a case of gathering more until you eventually fade. You're a dying person, but you're getting ready to live, just like him. Let today change your perspective. No longer living people just on the wind down to death, but dying people on the path to new life with God our Father, through Christ our Lord. Let me pray. Father, we thank you for the wonderful news of this day. The news that Jesus Christ, your Son, died but did not stay dead. It is incredibly hard to comprehend sometimes. We find ourselves with the Corinthians saying there is no resurrection of the dead. But we hear the witness of those first followers who, as a movement, should have puffed out and died. But they didn't, and they kept going because they saw Christ alive, and your Spirit moved in them, and the world was changed forever. Father, this morning I pray you would change our perspective so that we wouldn't see ourselves as people who are just gathering barnacles, living on the way to death. But we'd understand, Father, that though we are dying people, that when we trust Christ, we're on the way to life. Amen.